Hello, welcome in something that I can call IoT Decoded. It's a podcast and a vlog. Something new I want to test, it would be about actuality on LP1 domain. So LP1 in for low power wide area network. So basically the technology of allowing Internet of Things to communicate and work on battery for a really long period. Okay, and at low cost. That's the purpose of this technology. And so the purpose is to share some monthly actuality and share my opinion and the community opinion on those events. It's something new I want to test. So I'm really happy to get feedback from you on the content, the duration, the type of post I'm talking about, and I want to see if something I can do on a monthly basis to share information and knowledge on this technology. So feel free to comment, feel free to post me some link to discuss in the next version if this makes sense. And so let's start with what has touched me during this July-August month, with different posts I've read on the internet and think I want to go back on. The first one I've seen is a report on the LP1 market. It's a report that has been made by EHS consulting stuff. So they made a report about the LP1 market, and we have not a lot of information on the EHS website. They are selling the report, so no information on this, but we have on press different documents, different articles presenting a summary of this report, and it was really confusing to see that and surprising. So I had to make some research, and we had debate on the different social network about the content of this document, the study. Personally, I really don't like the study that explains that one technology is better than the other, and we win against the other on the IoT domain, because in fact all the technology we are talking about are technologies that are on different markets, different targets. Some are for high-end. It's a case of LTE-M and NB-IoT with actually a high cheap price, able to get a large bandwidth but consuming more energy. Okay, and we are low-end market with Sigfox or A1, where we are really efficient, cheap cost, about under $1. With a really low power, the ability to really work for 10 years on battery. I mean, normal battery, not a big battery. Okay, and so you cannot really compare each of them. There are different markets, so there are different things. So basically, this study where I try to show that some are dead and so on, which make no sense for me. And this study basically is we can summarize it in a table of number. So this table of number basically gives information about volume, current volume, and forecast volume for different technologies. And for the volume, it was really surprising to see that for LoRa, the volume for 2017-2019 is 2019 78 million devices. Sigfox 6 million for 2018. 12 million for 2019, okay? And for NB-IoT, we had a volume for 2017 at 5.5 million and 2019 at 65 million, basically, with the L2M, which is really slow. I don't talk about other, we don't know what is in the other. So that's for the market, and it was really surprising for two reasons. I mean, the number of LoRaWAN device here is really high compare what we see on the network. I mean, when we are in the community, you see what are the level of communication and so on, and we are really far away of this level. Sorry, and for NB-IoT, it was really surprising because the norm has been finalized mid 2016. So having already in 2017 5.5 million devices deployed. There's an issue because you have a design cycle of 1 year, 1 year, 1 year and a half, and so it's really surprising to have this volume. So I would like to understand where this volume come from. So I taken a look to Semtech to see if we can find this volume, and yes, it was easy in fact to find it. If we take a look to the 2019 report, it's complicated because Semtech annual financial annual is ending beginning of a year, so basically the 2019 report is the end of 2018. So at the beginning of 2019, they have 87 million of LoRa-based N-node deployed, so it means that it's the number of chips they have sold at this date. Okay, so that's interesting, and there was some interesting also in the table provided by EHS, because they have indicated a number for LoRa technology, which is not LoRaWAN, and LP1 is LoRaWAN. LoRa is a level 2 technology, so it's an end-to-end technology, point-to-point communication, which is totally different. Okay, it's like comparing Ethernet communication versus TCP/IP communication, basically. So it's not exactly the same thing. So it means that in fact it's this number. It's not a number of connected devices. It's the number of chips that has been sold by LoRa. And the number of chips sold by LoRa, a part is used for something different than LoRaWAN, because LoRa technology is really useful for local communication with long distance, so for low energy, if you have a remote control, if you have a smart home system, not connected to LoRaWAN, but just to connect a sensor to a central system, the LoRa technology is really good for that, and really used for that. So it's not LoRaWAN, okay? So there is a part which is not to be counted in part of the LP1, and also when you count the number of devices that has been produced or sold by the by Semtech, you avoid to calculate the level of stocks that are on the wholesaler and the level of stock you have on a fine product and so on. So at the end, you have a lot of chip that have been sold but are not connected, okay, which makes a big number but not relevant when we are talking about LP1 connection. So there is a big difference. So basically, these numbers here, they are interesting, we have the source, but they are pure bullshit in this table. That's interesting. Something that can confirm that these numbers are bullshit in terms of LP1 is the number of gateways. We have 243,000 LoRaWAN, LoRa-based gateway. So not of all are LoRaWAN. Okay, some can be a proprietary protocol, but just assume that they are LoRaWAN. If you check the number of LoRa-based node related to the number of base station, it means that you have about 400 LoRa nodes per base station. I mean, it's a bit strange. If you are an initiator, a LoRaWAN initiator like I am, for example, in my city, you see all the traffic around on LoRaWAN. And I can promise there's no 400 devices on my antenna. And what is more interesting, if you take a look on my area, there is two public networks, plus TTN, plus some private gateways, plus the gateway I have in stock here. So if I made accumulation of this, I have about, for the same locality, I have about 5 gateways. So it means that to have a balance between all that, it means that I should have around me something like 8 multiplied by 400 devices, which is totally absurd. Okay, so for these two reasons, can promise that these numbers are totally bullshit in terms of LPWAN connection. They are real in terms of chip sell by Semtech, and it's a really good news because it means that Semtech is making money with this device, and it means that there is a perennity, a durability for this technology because thanks to the money that Semtech makes. So that's a really good news, but it's bullshit to see it in this table. For NB-IoT, so it was surprising to have this number. As I said previously, the norms has been finished 6 months before, so it's strange to have device at this point. So I've found some studies also on chip market for NB-IoT, and the number are corresponding. Here they are in a million US dollar, but if you take a look to the expected volume of money for 2019, which is 272 million dollar, it's regarding the price of NB-IoT chip, it's something really relevant with the 64, the difference between the last or the 40 something devices that has been has been used in 2019. So this chip market forecast is also something relevant for this table. So it means that the same thing has been made for NB-IoT as for LoRaWAN. The table in the IHS study seems to take into account the chip market and not the connectivity market. Okay, so basically there is 1 year of delay in this case. As for NB-IoT, I mean, you cannot use for different for private network or point-to-point communication line for LoRa. Okay, so it's produced to be connected, but it's not because you produce a chip that it will be used in an end-user application and connected to a network. Okay, so if we have something like 1 year split, it's a shift, it has an impact on the global table you have here. Mostly when you take a look at the end of the table where there is forecast in future and doubling every year. So that's something fun. Okay, so that's for the current number, and here you see that I mean, it's not really honest, or I don't know, maybe the guy is honest, but it's just bad guy. I mean, just I don't know. Bref. So that was interesting. And the other thing that was interesting, if we take a look at forecast that has been made by the guy who are doing a forecast with NB-IoT chip, I found another study on IoT Now, and so it was Zodiac. I mean, that's made a study with Huawei and so on. And so they've made a study around 2018, expecting 106 million NB-IoT device deployed in 2018, and 600 million in 2023. So if we take a look to this forecast and compare to the one of IHS, we see that the IHS one are really far away from the one coming from this study. And as the study is before 2018, and 2018 is in the past, so now we have the number. So the forecast was 106 million, and it seems that the reality is 27 million. So it's 5 times less. Okay, so, I mean, people are selling cheap. They want to have high forecast of doing cheap. They say, we have the capability to produce this, but it's totally different than the market saying, I want to add the chip because I have a use case to deploy and now I want to make it. Okay, so it's this forecast basically are pure bullshit. Another forecast that is interesting also to compare this study of EHS with other studies that has been made. It's an older study from Ericsson, looking at the global market and saying for the wider area IoT, so LP1 basically, for 2022, the forecast is 2.1 billion of devices. And if we take a look to the EHS study for 2022, they are the big total of 1.1 billion. So basically, half of what Ericsson has predicted. Ericsson is older, so we can expect that EHS is have a better precision because it's a newer study. But I mean, they have made a mistake by they are forecast twice the size of EHS. Potentially, EHS also have made a mistake around 50% of this or 80%. So, forecast the volume of forecast here is globally wrong. I don't think that Ericsson are bad guys. Basically, also. So, that was interesting to see that. The other thing I have take a look to this study is the way they have considered the growth of the different technologies. So don't consider the volume itself, but just considering how they think the technology will progress. I didn't read the study, so maybe they have good explanation for this, but my point of view, it's a bit strange. Because for LoRa, so they have made the assumption globally that the growth per year will be something stable. We don't know why, but for LoRaWAN, the growth is 155 globally percent per year. And it's stable all along the year from 2019 to 2023. Well, why not? But why? Okay. For NB-IoT, they have considered that it will be stable also, but it will be 200%. 200% up to 2022, and we don't really know why, but in 2023, it decreased to 151. My point of view, it decreased because it was too high and a bit stupid, so okay, the number has been more beautiful like this, okay, but why 200? Why 200%? I mean, we know that the NB-IoT growth is really good in China, and China is leader for this and so on. So on first, in a short term, it makes sense, really makes sense. But to have the volume that is indicated for 2022, 2023, it means that the NB-IoT must be deployed worldwide and used more worldwide and not only in China. And even if it's used only in China, it means that later in the future, it will have to be used in other countries, otherwise, if it's just China's technology, I mean, it is dead or it's kind of proprietary thing, so it's not really interesting, basically. So, I think there is too many things that we don't yet know about the deployment of this technology to be sure of that. And more of this, for NB-IoT and LTE-M, we are going to have new revision of this because, in fact, they are part of 5G. NB-IoT is Cat NB1, actually. It will buy Cat NB2 in 5G with some difference, new chip, new capability, low power, and so on. So we're going to have a change of this. And for LTE-M, it's going to be the same. So for LTE-M, we have Cat N1 and Cat N2 coming. Cat N2 would be a really big difference because Cat N1 is not really a really good solution. So we should have things changing between 2020 and 2023, and we don't see this in the number. So, I mean, in my point of view, if we don't see this, it's because many things have been missed or just don't consider. And for LTE-M, we see that there is a big progress in 2019. Okay, it's the first year, so numbers are big. And in 2018, was decreased, and the volume is decreasing year after year, which is really surprising because LTE-M here is the only IP technology. It means that you can directly communicate with the device with an IP address. And there is a big market for this. And actually, all the market existing with a connected camera, connected alarm for home and so on, they are working on 2G technology with SMS or IP technologies. And so this market will have to move to another technology because the 2G, 3G network are going down, so they will move to LTE or NB-IoT or potentially other, but logically, if they were working on 2G, 3G, it's because they have power inside the object, so they are totally compliant with LTE-M and NB-IoT. And so all this stuff should move, but here we have something which is really low in terms of volume, so LTE-M. So it's a bit strange to see that also, and my point of view, quite false. But what is more interesting is what is done with Sigfox. With Sigfox, we have a growth between 2017-2018, which is 200.5%, 250%, sorry. And in 2018-2019, we are growth of 200%, basically, which is, I mean, it's decreasing, but we are per 200. I mean, it's easy when you have low volume and after it changes a bit. But so we are at this point, and they have decided, and there is no communication about Sigfox saying that. So they have decided that this number will decrease year after year. So it's 167 in 2020, and it goes to 135% of growth in 2023. Why? I mean, in parallel, the number of countries is doubling every 18 months. So that's a fact. Since many years, it's doubling every 18 months. It will slow, you will going slow, because at the end, you can do that for more than 5 years after you've covered the world. But it's an important number, so it means that you can have a lot of use case deployed in a lot of places. And actually, the network are densifying. So it means that you really have the countries covered entirely. So you really have a strong public network that is growing. And they say, okay, there is more network, there are more capabilities, I mean, the market size is bigger, but your growth will decrease, which is a bit strange in terms of analysis seen like that. Okay, so I think that they would like to have kind of negative message on Sigfox. And the other point that I did not notice, which is really important, because I read some articles saying, yeah, Sigfox is dying, the level is really low, and so on. What is killing a company is not the volume of connection, it's the volume of revenue. Okay, that's what is interesting. And here we are two different models between LoRa and Sigfox. LoRa is a chip-based revenue. Semtech is earning money because they are selling chip. And one chip is $1 one time. You sell a chip, it's $1. The chip is used for 10 years, it's just $1 for the chip. Okay? For Sigfox, it's a subscription model. They are a network operator. So it means that you have one subscription, you pay every year for this subscription. So if you have one subscription on a year, a second one on second year, the second year you gain $2 instead of $1 for it. Okay, so it means that if we take a look into to the revenue, so I've taken an assumption, which is average revenue per communication for per connection for Sigfox, €6. You can change that completely, okay? But it just to explain the difference between the two. If we take a look to the Semtech revenue, actually for the year 2018 and the technology, they have made €32 million. Euro or dollar, which is really good regarding the investment they have made for this technology, which is about €20 million some years ago. So it's really profitable things for Semtech. Okay, but in the same time, the revenue for Sigfox, even if the number are really smaller, is €36 million. So they are around the same revenue for a volume which is totally different. And at the end, taking my assumption, which are false, okay, the revenue on Sigfox are higher than the revenue on LoRa. You can tweak my numbers, potentially you will change this level, but at the end, I mean the average revenue. Considering the number which are globally, in my point of view, ultra pessimistic for Sigfox, the Sigfox numbers are still profitable. So it means that, okay, maybe it's not the volume they are expecting in the company, but it don't mean that there is a risk for the technology or something like this, which is not the, what the study tried to say, or the article I've read about the technology tried to say, which was interesting in my point of view to share. Okay, so that was something, I'm sorry I have taken some time on this, but it was something that was, I think, really interesting to share, because the number of bad communication I saw in LP1 is really horrible, and the fight between the fight between LP1 technology I see just don't make sense. I mean, all the technology have a place for in the IoT. The IoT is really large, the use cases are really different from each other, and as a consequence, each of the big technology were actually have a place, and each of them have a part of the market for it. So there's no fight, in fact. We just have to work together. It will be really more efficient and better. Every time we have a fight, it reduce the maturity of the market, because the company will ask questions, will wait to see what will happen. And so we are lost in time. And at the end, I mean, 5G technology coming, 3GPP technology will not compete LoRaWAN and Sigfox in certain domain where we want something which is really low cost, with a really low power and so on. It's not planned. So no interest to try to say they will be leader and so on. Make no sense. Okay. Or you have some paper to sell, and it's interesting in that case, potentially. Okay, so good news. Now, I really appreciate the LoRaWAN distance world record they have made this summer, with 766 kilometers for a communication using LoRaWAN on the Thing network. So really, really nice. And guys, you rocks. It was really cool to see that they had a good communication, and so you can see that on thethingnetworks.org. I mean, it's open source, so you can get all the detail of the experience they have made, how they do it, and so on. And you can have the source code. Basically, you can do it yourself, but there are some restrictions, basically, if you want to do it, because the condition are a bit special. So long distance record on LP1 is something that can happen if you can have some specific protocol to ensure you have some result like this one. We are going to talk a bit about the detail, but they are really rare. Okay, the LoRaWAN communication is made to have a communication for 10 to 15 kilometers. Okay, so having a communication up to 766 kilometers is really performance, and is really something exceptional, okay? But it's interesting to see that. So it's something in the LP1 domain we are used to, this kind of challenge to get the longest performance. We have a specialist of this in the Sigfox ecosystem, which is Hide&Seek tracker solution. He's doing a lot of analytics on the communication and the distance, and the record for Sigfox, I think it's the last one, it's 1,151 kilometer between a device and an antenna. So it's something really, really interesting. There is a difference between the LoRaWAN record and the Hide&Seek record. In fact, when we do record on LP1, we do them in particular circumstance. And there is two circumstances that helps to get record. The first one is the one that Hide&Seek have experimented multiple times, is to use a communication over the sea. Because between the sea, the water and the sea, and the air, there is a thin layer of salted air that is really, really good to propagate the communication. And over the sea, there's no noise, and the antenna around the sea globally have no noise around and in a better shape for receiving really low-level messages. So that's why it's a good circumstance to make a distance record. So this in Sigfox domain is efficient because there is a lot of base stations that are installed in a really good spot just near the sea. So we have good spot, we have low noise, we have professional antenna that are installed, and so it's the best place to have world record. When we use balloon, because the other way to have a record is to use a balloon, so we talk about this. When there was balloon with Sigfox, it was more the number of base stations that has been touched by the signal that is counted, that's looking at the distance especially. So the second way to have a record is to use a balloon. Why to use a balloon? It's because if you want to send a message from Earth to a base station, you will be limited by two things. The first thing is the obstacle you will find in front of you. If you have mountains, the radio wave won't pass through the mountain, and so the signal will be blocked, and your capability to have a long distance will be blocked also. So if you go upper, you will eventually pass over the mountain, that's good. The other thing is that the Earth is not plate. Sorry for some people, it's rounded. And so even if you have no mountain, at a certain distance, your way will go through the universe, okay, and will touch no antenna. So if you go upper on the mountain, you will have a better angle to touch some antenna that are at a higher distance. So that's why the balloon was the right solution to get a success on LoRaWAN. And so this is what they did. And there was no big surprise about the antenna that gathers the messages at a really long distance. The antenna that was far away of the device is an antenna in Grenoble. Grenoble, so it's a native place of LoRa, and this antenna is well known from the community by the community, because this antenna is on the top of a mountain, and it's a really high quality antenna with gain and so on, in a place where it's not a lot of noise. So I mean, it's a professional antenna that has been deployed there, and so it's a really, really good condition to have signals that are coming from far away. So no real surprise about the antenna that has made this this record, and that's, I mean, the problem to get world record with TTN is actually the number of professional installation that is not too big actually. It's more, I mean, it's a community network, so everyone deploys its antenna with the money he can spend on it and the means he have to put it on top of something. So the quality of the network limits a bit this, and this is why we have this good and really nice record, and we can expect, I think, better record on LoRaWAN. It's actually more a question of quality of the network, number of antenna deployed on top of mountain and stuff like this. But there is some capability to get a better record for the future. So it's an interesting story, and I hope that some other people will try to challenge this record and get something more. So good guy, thanks guy for sharing this experience. What really, really, really good for us. About networks, an actuality that I really like this summer, it's a bit particular to me because I went there for my summer, so I had the ability to test it. It's a communication from the Sigfox network operator in UK that has announced that the deployment of the network has really progressed, and now they are proud of this, and they are, I mean, it's they are prude, and it's good to have them prude of this because it's a really good network compared to what we have by the past. It was, I mean, UK was a mess for Sigfox since year, and now it's really something interesting with a really good coverage, like in France, Spain, and so on. And not only UK, because also Ireland is really well covered. So I spend my summer in passing through the UK and going in Ireland, where I had a big turn on the west, north to south, west side of Ireland, and I experienced a really good network, really well covered. I had communication everywhere following me, tracking me. So that's really good. So even between France and England through a boat, I've been covered for the whole trip. So that's really interesting in terms of use case we can deploy there. So congratulations, guys. That's good to see that. Another announce that was really interesting me in Sigfox domain is it's about an extension of the contract between Securitas and Sigfox, but I mean that's their business, so I mean I don't care, I'm happy for them, but that's it. But with this extension, the communications that we have seen is indicating that Securitas is interesting because some new feature will arrive on the network for them about image transmission and audio messages. Wow! Since many months and years, I say to people, oh, Sigfox, it's just for sensors data, no pictures, no sound, make no sense. And this guy say, we want to do a picture, I mean, take picture over the network and make sound and so on. Wow, that's interesting. What are they announcing and how can we do that? So I've read a post on this on DISK91.com, so you can check this more in detail. But basically, if actually we want to transfer a picture over a Sigfox using the duty cycle to transfer it immediately, we have 426 bytes available for this transmission, which is a bit small, okay, but in fact it's not impossible, okay. I was surprised to do that test. You can have a picture transmitted with this volume. Clearly, if you have someone on the picture, you won't be able to identify him, but if you are taking a picture of a room, and if someone is in this room, you will see that someone is in this room. So in terms of security, it can make sense. But it's not, in my point of view, what is said in this communication from Securitas, because they have a new capability. So I assume that we're going to have higher quality picture. And so I see different way to have high quality picture, and so to have a better bandwidth for the network. The first one and the more probable one is to have a higher speed network, 600 bits per second. Why this one? Because it's the norm in North America. So the base station are already able to work with this frequency, I mean this bandwidth. So 600 bits per second, so it's six times more than we have actually. So that's really interesting. It means more messages. It more means less battery for transmitting the same information and so on. It's not free. I mean, if we go more quickly, it means that we have a loss of sensibility and potentially the distance that a message can reach will be lower. But in Western Europe, we're really dense network. So actually, we can, if you are in a city and you are doing 600 bits per second, there's no problem of coverage. So that's the more probable thing, as everything is ready for this. The other one is also to work on the replication. I mean, in Sigfox, every message sent is replicated two times. So you have three times the message transmitted at the end. Okay, and we could have a way to manage that by reducing the number of repetition, and it's a way to also have more bandwidth, because if we have less repeats, we can better use the duty cycle. And the last thing we can do that could be really interesting also, it's to modify the size of frame, I mean allowing longer frame, as we have a smaller frame, but we could have a lower frame. You may have to know that Sigfox efficiency actually is 48%. It means that the number of useful payload divided by the full message payload at best is 48%, which is really low. And if we have longer frame, take an example of 64 bytes, we can reach 83% of efficiency, which is really better. And if we consider 600 bytes per second plus two repeat instead of one emission plus one repeat instead of two repeats and 60 byte frames, we could have for the duty cycle 1.5 kilobytes of data we can transmit immediately, and with 1.5 kilobytes you can transmit a good quality image where we are able to identify someone or exactly see what is happening somewhere. So that's interesting to see that, and I'm really waiting for more technical communication on that point. Which is a bit afraiding me is that with Sigfox we have announcements. Then generally we have a B2B deployment of what has been announced with a specific company, Erith Securitas, and the time to get it accessible by the whole community, all the device makers and so on, is generally 18 to 24 months later, which is really long. And so, no, I mean, I want to test all of that. It's really cool. But will I be able soon? It's something which is unclear, and it's a bit annoying. So one of these technologies that has been announced 24 months ago or more, 36, I don't know, it's Monarch. So Monarch now is there, accessible to everyone. So that's a really, really good news. We are waiting since for many time. Just to let you know, the first device Monarch ready and sold is a tracker from Louis Vuitton for luggage. It has been put on the market about 18 months ago now. And so the technology has been announced at least 6 months or 12 months before, so it's a really long way to get the device, but now we have some device and development kit available to do Monarch. What is really interesting with Monarch? Monarch is a technology that is allowing a device to know in what frequency it can work on. Sorry, it was not really English. So the idea is that you have a device, you put it in Europe, you have to switch to its communication to 868 megahertz. But you have to know that it's in Europe to do that. If you have no GPS, you don't know that you are in Europe. So thanks to Monarch, you are listening different frequencies. You get a beacon coming from Sigfox on a specific frequency, on the 868 frequency, and you know that you are in Europe. So you can communicate in the right frequency. You move the device, you deploy it in North America, you will get the beacon on another frequency, so 955 or something like this, okay? And this device will know that it is in North America, and so it will switch to this frequency and communicate on the right frequency. So that's really interesting. And what is interesting with Monarch is that this technology, I mean, it's not open, but the way it is made, it can be listened by anything. So basically, a LoRa device could be able in the future to get a beacon from Monarch Sigfox solution and know that it can switch to the right frequency also. So not sure that when Sigfox did it, they did it for everyone, but that's interesting that this technology that is available on Sigfox is a technology that is available for all the community, which is really interesting, even for non-LP1 potentially. Okay, so Monarch is now there. There is a first dev kit coming from Unibiz. A bit expensive, but I mean, interesting to do tests. I hope to get one really soon. I will be able to post the different tests on it, so stay tuned. This is based on a Lighton module, which is one of the first Monarch module certified. The certification of module has been really long for the device, the module maker, so Lighton is one of them. And so now we can make devices on this techno, so that's really, really, really good actually. To finish, one point about security information. It's about a flaw that affects 200 million devices. It's a lot of bugs that has been discovered on a real-time embedded operating system, which is VxWorks, which is a proprietary system, really well used in the industrial domain, and it's a closed source operating system. And so, I mean, now we have 200 million devices with some issues, and what is not good is that the security issues are on the TCP/IP stack, which means that all these devices that are connected to a network are a potential target for future worms and so on. So the good news is that even if we are talking about 200 million, I assume that a lot of part of them, I mean, as an example, they have identified elevators. I'm not sure that a lot of elevators are connected to a TCP/IP network in company. So potentially there's one a bit protected against big attack. But for routers or for industrial automats and so on, there is a real risk behind this. Why this was interesting to me over the volume, because the volume is really high here, and it means that we won't, this is 10% of this only will be patched in the 2 or 3 coming years. So above the volume, it's one of the problems I think in the IoT domain compared to the computer science more general domain, is that it's really closed source. In the IoT, the source are sometimes open source, are using BSD, because BSD, you can take it, you can put it in your device and tell nothing to no one. Okay, so even if you find some bugs, you can just fix it for yourself, okay? And other solutions are proprietary system, you know, like Windows. Okay, it means that it's written by someone and you have don't have the source code, you can analyze, and okay, you have to trust that person. The problem is, like for other proprietary system and so on, I mean, no one search for the bug until someone do it. And here the problem is that the version from 2.06 has been impacted by this bug. It's more than 13 years ago now, and it means that no one found that before. And if it was more open with the source code available, with a large community searching for bug on it and so on, maybe it would have been discovered 10 years ago. And instead of 200 million devices, it would have been 20 million devices or less. Okay, and so I think one of the problems around the security in IoT is around quality of code practice we have and so on, but also the use of proprietary stuff, the lack of public and open source SDK and so on. So this was relevant, this post, regarding to this point of view I have on the security on the IoT domain. Okay, so take care of this if you have such device, because I think that regarding the number of machines impacted, we may have some worm coming in the future that could impact industrial production means, industrial equipment or thing like this, and it could have a big impact on different things. So take care of this. Okay, so I'm at the end of this first blog presentation. I hope that it was not too long for you. It was interesting and you learned a lot of things. As I said at the beginning, please give me some feedback. I want to see if it's interesting to continue to have a search thing, or if it's just interesting me, and in that case, I will do something else that will be better for the community than it. But if you are interesting, please tell me, suggest me for some link for the next edition, potentially in 1 month, and during that time, stay tuned on my Twitter account or my YouTube Shane, there are some coming news and tests coming, so maybe a good interesting thing to learn following me on social network. Talk to you soon. Bye.